This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Chapter 1. Situating. In nature and in human societies, the course of every action and event depends on the context in which it happens. That is the premise of this book. And its thesis is that scientific investigations of these activities are likewise best carried out in context. How could anyone think otherwise, one might ask, when the force of situations is a fact of daily experience? Yet in the culture of modern science, at least at its high end, true knowledge is taken to be what is true everywhere, in any context or in no context. So the scientific procedures considered exemplary, experiment, hypothetico-deduction, randomized trials, statistical proofs of two variable cause and effect, are those that eliminate or define away contexts as extraneous complications. A sharp social and epistemic boundary is thus drawn between the methods of science and the customary ways of everyday life. Desituating has become a signature characteristic of modern science, while science that does not control for context but accepts it is regarded as less than best practice. These are, of course, ideals. In reality, much science does not evade or suppress situation in a quest for laws that transcend all particulars of place and time. Situating practices are common in the human and social sciences, and in field and environmental sciences, investigations in situ are no less valued than those performed ex situ in labs and offices. The one creates conceptual space and investigative opportunities for the other, and mixed modes are not uncommon. The more one looks for science in situ, the more one finds. Situating, arguably, is no less characteristic of modern science than its opposite, just less visible and less valued. It is seen as the preliminary groundwork for real science, assembling useful facts but yielding no proofs, that is the modern default view. Part of my purpose in writing this book is to make science in situ a bit more visible, and to expose the disconnect between the powerful but restrictive ideals of desituating science and the reality of creative achievement in sciences carried out in place. I write from the context side and for it, as a humanist historian whose business it is to recover the forgotten or misremembered contexts of historical actions and events, I have a brief to make for context. My particular subject here is an intensive kind of situated science that I call resident science. The paradigmatic and most familiar resident practice is the participant observation of social anthropologists who reside in a community for months or years, observing its customs and culture and taking part in a limited way in its activities. Participation is not a necessary element of resident science, however. In studies of animal communities, for example, observers cannot or should not take part. A virtue of resident science as a historical category is that it treats a range of human and natural sciences together that are customarily treated separately. And though it is a small subset of the more capacious and diverse category of situated science, resident science epitomizes the defining character of that larger group. I chose it for my subject because it is a well-defined and bounded topic and a manageable one for a shortish book on a very large subject. What, then, are the defining features of resident science? One is its reliance on intensive personal observing in situ by observers who in effect operate inside their objects of study. Resident science is strongly observational and often open-ended and exploratory. It seeks generalities in patterns of observed particulars more than in deductions from abstract laws and theories. Resident observers treat the contexts and situations in which they and their subjects act not as stage settings for actions, but as essential elements of phenomena. Resident science is co-resident. It is situated in that observers are themselves present in the situations and actions they observe. And it is situating in that subjects are observed in the natural or social contexts in which they normally act. This double-situatedness of cohabiting observers and observed is the essence of resident science as I understand it. My current venture into resident science builds on the extensive inquiries into place and practice in science that have in the last 30 years become a defining issue in science studies. The principal themes of this body of scholarship are now widely familiar, that places are not neutral stages for scientific activities, but directly affect how they are carried out and received, that all scientific knowledge is initially the product of some particular material and social locale, that some places, truth spots, can give credibility to knowledge claims, and that in becoming what everyone knows, the universal view from nowhere, knowledge must travel and transcend locality of place. These issues of place are important and fruitful. They are not my subject here, however. I am concerned solely with the relations of scientists and their subjects in their common contexts of co-residence, how these working relations are created and how they operate or don't. Whereas concepts of place have typically emphasized geographical or spatio-cultural features, residence is less a spatial than a relational and ecological instrument of thought. So I have kept the more familiar physical issues of place in the background and focused on the activities and experience of investigation, typically of human or animal communities, from the inside, and how co-residence leads not to the erasure of contexts, but to their persistence in the facts and concepts of the science produced. Resident science stays in context and keeps context in. Its best stories are inside stories. Situating science. To see how situating is achieved, it is useful to look first at its more familiar opposite. Desituating has been accomplished by various means. Most simply, and superficially, it is achieved rhetorically, by stripping written accounts of situating particulars of who and where, in order to create the impression of timeless universality, of nature speaking, not I or we. This is the process famously described by Bruno Latour and Stephen Wolger in their landmark book on making facts in laboratory science. More substantively, desituating is achieved conceptually by embedding things or phenomena in an abstract framework of theory or modeling. Subjects may also be materially desituated by physically relocating them to sequestered environments designed for the sole purpose of scientific analysis, in which disturbing particularities of context can be controlled or, more or less, eliminated. Laboratories, museums, gardens, aquaria, clinics, field stations, workshops, and offices are familiar types. This actual desituating is the favored method of modern science. The iconic images of desituated nature are familiar: rats in mazes, small animals in cages, rows of maize in weeded and watered plots, fruit flies in jars, pure strain bacteria in petri dishes, monkeys in vivaria or backyard caged colonies. In the human sciences, there are native informants answering questionnaires on an ethnographer's veranda, kids in classrooms watched through one-way glass, or college undergraduates in psychology experiments, perhaps the closest thing there is to a standard human organism. And there are the objects extracted from their natural or social contexts: animal skins in cabinet drawers, dried plants pressed in folios, archaeological and ethnographic artifacts in cabinets, and excised tissues and organs in vitro that stand in for intact organisms in vivo. And let us not forget the models of population cycles that may or may not match the real things, or the reassuringly smooth curves of neoclassical economics, stand-ins for economies that in reality are given to irrational, yet perfectly natural swerves, swoops and dives. The practical and epistemic advantages of desituating are clear enough. Things and phenomena are more precisely categorized and measured without the complications of real-world contexts, and more securely treated statistically and experimentally. Hypotheses of cause and effect are more easily generated and tested when single variables are isolated and analyzed without the uncertainties of particular situations. Observations and experiments that are reliably reproducible are more easily credited as true than are those that vary with circumstance. Although the noise of context is inherently part of the scientific signal, noisy signals are harder to sell as true knowledge. So science that is presented as clear signal without the context enjoys an epistemic free ride, while situated science must be continually justified and defended. The social advantages of desituating are no less vital, Given a society where professional reputation and advancement in a career depend on regular publications produced by communally sanctioned procedures, situating practices facilitate the steady production of results, enabling practitioners to publish and not perish. And because they stand up to critique and peer review, they are more effective in making and defending reputations. Situating practices are, in contrast, less reliably productive, and because they are carried out in person and in particular contexts, they will likely be harder to represent as objective. Results that are not presentable as definitive answers to specific hypotheses will be harder to get funded and published. It is little wonder, then, that desituating sciences are high on the totem pole of scientific prestige, while those that embrace situation are lower down. All this is not to say that situating science has been abandoned in modernity. It obviously has not. Natural history has lost standing in the age of experiment, but it may well be pursued by more people and more productively now than ever before. In ecology and environmental sciences, the modern descendants of natural history, in situ observing is common practice. In some sciences it defines the mainstream, as in social anthropology and wildlife ecology, in others it animates significant subfields, as in animal behavior and small group sociology and human relations. In many sciences recurring efforts, not always sustained, are made to resituate abstracted objects of study, as in evolutionary biology, see below, or social psychology, and even a science as devotedly abstract as economics. There are good reasons why, despite their practical and epistemic disabilities, situating practices have retained a significant place in modern science. They restore contextual meanings that are too easily sacrificed to single-minded pursuit of analytic rigor. They keep scientists mindful of the fact that contingency and uncertainty are essential aspects of phenomena, and that analytic categories and cause and effect connections may not be so securely real as they seem to be when identified in unnatural isolation. Open-ended exploration revitalizes domains of theory that with time and use have become merely self-confirming, and enlarges conceptions of data that have become narrowed to just what can be used in rigorous proofs of cause and effect. Intensive study of particular cases in context challenges a methodology of deductive hypothesis testing that becomes unhealthily hegemonic, as the political scientist John Gehring has observed. Situating is a useful reminder that just because an idea is true doesn't mean it can be proved. And just because an idea can be proved doesn't mean it's true. Observing phenomena in context is, in some, not an imperfect substitute for proper science. In many instances it is proper science. Abstraction and universalism are not in themselves the problem, only the assumption that they are the best method for every subject and situation. There seems to be a growing recognition in science and in history of science that universal laws may not be the best way, and are certainly not the only way, to deal with complex phenomena. One size does not fit all. Those who have explored the social and epistemic advantages of decontextualizing have generally not symmetrically inquired what is lost when phenomena are stripped of context. In his pathbreaking essay on Louis Pasteur's anthrax field trials, for example, Bruno Latour demonstrates how Pasteur captured anthrax for laboratory medicine by relocating the phenomenon from a pasture, where infection occurred contingently and mysteriously, it seemed, and farmers and veterinaries were the authorities, to a laboratory from which contingency was banished, and where infection was made reliably repeatable and explicable as the effect of a certain species of microbe. That indisputable cause and effect gave bacteriologists effective ownership of the anthrax disease, the one road to truth passed through their labs. It remained nonetheless true, however, that in the real world of herds and meadows, infection depends crucially on the particulars of environment and circumstance. And these cannot be properly studied by pastorians in labs, but only in pastures by those who know them and know how nature and human husbandry work. The question here is, how are objects of science kept in their pastures, so to speak, or returned to them from Paris labs for scientific study in situ? There are degrees and varieties of situating practices. Rhetorical situating. I was there, and here's what I saw and did, believe me, was once the usual form of natural histories, and is still occasionally used to create a sense of virtual witnessing. Situating is also accomplished by expanding the conceptual frames in which phenomena are set. Genes reset in the whole machinery of gene expression, cells in nets of cell communication, microbial species in microbiomes of vast diversity, plant and animal species, including the human species, in whole ecosystems. A striking recent case is the resituating of the mathematical genetics of altruism and eusociality, think ants and termites, or us, into the larger frame of ecology and evolution by Edward O. Wilson and others. It is not just any species that develops eusocial traits, it turns out, but those few that have chanced to evolve ecologically to a point where eusocial tendencies can be amplified by natural selection. The origin of altruism cannot be deduced by a prioristic reasoning based on general models, Wilson writes. It can, however, be revealed by reconstructing actual histories with empirical data. Abstract models may similarly be given richer conceptual surrounds. Theoretical economics affords a good example in the logical game of prisoner's dilemma, in which two idealized rational actors, kept incommunicado, weigh the benefits and costs of cooperation or betrayal. This universalized model, admitted by all to be totally unrealistic, is made, modestly, more true to life by adding little stories with more actors and interactions and particulars of social context. A reductive logic of decision-making is thus resituated in imagined, but plausible scenes of choice. In principle, a story could be invented for any actual situation, though that would in the end transform a reductio ad absurdum into an elaboratio ad absurdum. One is reminded of Jorge Luis Borges's fable of an ancient college of cartographers, who created a map of their empire as big as the empire itself, a perfect but perfectly useless object that was finally abandoned, along with the college and all cartographers. More concretely, the situations of experimental subjects can be made materially more like those of nature or society. Mimetic situating, one might call such practices. Minimally, amenities, exercise wheels, natural nesting materials, may be added to animal cages in the hope of making captives' behavior more like what it would be in free life. Vivaria and aquaria are made more naturalistic by adding species or environments that afford cover from predators. Entire laboratories may be located in places whose climates and environments cannot be simulated. Alpine labs for thin air physiology, marine stations for littoral and intertidal environments, Arctic stations for cold climate science, or gardens in various climate zones for study of plant variation. Or actual situations in nature may be discovered or arranged that do in context what experiments do in labs, nature's experiments, and what I've called practices of place. Alternatively, objects extracted from their natural environments may be delivered to museums or herbaria together with context in the form of field notes detailing when and where objects were collected and from what natural or social situations, little stories of context that are not imagined now but real. Specimens may be accompanied by bits of material context for dioramas that mimic collecting sites. Museum curators and scientists resituated themselves when, rather than delegating fieldwork to amateurs and commercial collectors, they went afield to do their own gathering and observing, typically in seasonal expeditions. Epidemiologists, after the first flush of petri dish bacteriology, likewise went afield to observe how infections worked in actual situations, thereby making microbiology a kind of human ecology. Recurring or commuting situating, we might call these expeditionary practices. But the most thoroughly situating practice is residing for extended periods among subjects of study. Resident observing is not one practice, but a set of practices that vary with particular subjects and observers' aims and situations. Resident observers may become limited participants in their subjects' daily activities in order to experience for themselves ways of life, not their own, the standard practice of anthropologists. or they may take care not to involve themselves with subjects that do not tolerate participation, as ecologists and ethologists do with free-living animals. Residence is thus not mere physical propinquity, but an active relationship between observer and observed in contexts of co-residence, and the relations of cohabitating are my chief concern here. That is why I generally prefer the term situating to situated. The past tense situated invites us to regard situation as a set stage for actions. The present participle, situating, points to the actions themselves and highlights the fact that residing is a creative practice, transforming situations of life into those of science, and vice versa. In resident sciences, the practices and experiences of situating are most fully and openly on display. I would not want to leave readers thinking that desituating and situating science are dichotomous and incommensurable. I have dwelt on their differences to highlight the less familiar qualities of situating science. In fact, the two are often compatible and complementary. Thomas Guerin, for example, has shown how the sociologists of the Chicago School drew on the epistemic advantages of both lab and field to justify their use of city neighborhoods as research sites, shuttling with little sense of incongruity between the situating values of found, here, and immersed and the desituating values of made, anywhere, and detached. Chicago was for them simultaneously a laboratory of social science and a field of human ecology. There is still, to be sure, the ingrained modern bias favoring practices that desituate and universalize over those that situate and deal in particulars. Theoretical deduction and experiment need no justification. Observing and describing often do. That has been a plain fact of life and a subject of rueful complaint for many who have pursued science in situ, and it would be unhistorical to deny it. Yet that epistemic disadvantage has not prevented scientists from drawing on situating and observational practices if these do the job. To once more quote John Gehring, "methods, strictly defined, tend to lose their shape as one looks closer at their innards. There are few pure methods. And this is probably a good thing. Chastity is not necessarily an attribute to be cherished in research design. Impurity of practice is arguably one of the chief strengths and virtues of situating sciences. These constitute border zones in which varied scientific practices, together with those of everyday occupations, can be promiscuously and productively mixed. I examine in this book 6 cases of resident science. The ethnographic practice of participant observation is the first, exemplified by Bronislaw Malinowski's sojourn in the Trobriand Islands of Melanesia, 1916-19. My second and third cases are 2 resident investigations of modern societies by sociologists, Nels Andersons, of itinerant hobos in Chicago's so-called Hobohemia, 1921-23, and William F. White's, of Italian-American street corner cliques of young males in Boston's North End, 1937-40. Primatology is my fourth case, represented by Jane Goodall's long-term study of chimp behavior in the Gombe Stream Chimpanzee Reserve of Tanzania, 1960s and beyond. Finally, there are a pair of studies in wildlife ecology, Herbert Stoddard's pioneering life history of bobwhite quail in the longleaf pine end of upland Georgia, 1924-29, and the study of quail ecology and predation by Paul Arrington and Aldo Leopold in south-central Wisconsin, 1932-40s. In selecting these cases, I was guided by both programmatic and personal concerns. I came to the subject of resident science somewhat serendipitously, via a study of wildlife ecology, which I had thought was typical but realized was not. If I had come to the subject more deliberately, I asked myself, with what science would I have begun? Anthropology and Malinowski was the obvious answer, and that led easily to the sibling science of sociology and the Chicago School. To bridge the species and historiographical divide between human and animal science, the choice of primatology and Jane Goodall was an easy one. And for a concluding case, there was the one that had serendipitously opened the larger question of resident science, now substantially reconceptualized. I also had practical and personal reasons for choosing these particular cases. Each is richly documented in scientific publications, biographies, and autobiographies, a necessity, as I are determined not to use archival sources, the subjects are too many and too diverse to dig that deeply into each one. I also wanted individuals who would be engaging personal and intellectual company for the years it would take to learn about subjects of which I then had but a passing knowledge. I wanted good stories, inside stories, to tell of my actors' lives and their experiences with resident observing, which would be enjoyable both for me and for readers who, like me, are curious about all kinds of science but not aspiring specialists in any one. It is obvious that my cases of resident science do not constitute a natural group, in the sense of having common origins or interconnections, or of marking a historical trend. They do constitute, by design, a historiographical series from a fully representative case of resident practice to one that might arguably be a limiting case. Having no hypothesis to test, I do not ask the same questions of each subject, but rather follow lines of inquiry that seem most interesting and apartment. My approach, like those of my subjects, is analogical and exploratory. These are the qualities of case study generally. As the sociologist Howard Becker has forcefully argued, the best use of case study in the social sciences, and I would add in history, is not to produce universal laws or generalizations, but to discover features of social phenomena that analytic methods of sampling and hypothesis testing do not. Becker reasons analogically, finding that some variable plays a significant role in one case, we should reflexively ask if it might also be significant in others, where there was no obvious reason to look for it. By this freestyle cross-examining of cases, vital issues of social life may be brought to light. What reasoning by analogy from known cases gets you isn't guaranteed knowledge about an entire population of similar cases, but something more valuable and less ephemeral. A collection of connected researchable questions about a family of related phenomena. Ideas that can orient your next research from the first moments of aroused interest through the actual research. Becker regards case study not as an empirical preliminary to formal analysis of cause and effect, the common view, but as an exploration that enriches familiar categories and discovers new ones. It is a method, not of abstraction and universals, but of patterns discovered in empirical particulars. Clues and conjectures. The historian Carlo Ginzburg sets forth a similar vision of scientific and historical method in his brilliantly idiosyncratic 1980 essay on the method of clues. Ginzburg means by that phrase the practice of inferring from seemingly trivial observations the unseen realities of past or hidden actions. Sherlock Holmes is the iconic practitioner of the method of clues, the things that should be there but are not, barking dogs in the night, the unnoticed leavings that betray even the most careful criminals to the detective, who sees everything and has a deep knowledge of the world of material stuff and human behaviors. It is a situated practice of observing inside a natural or social world. It's how we navigate our own ways in the world, hence no doubt, the undying appeal of detective stories. Ginzburg's exemplars of the method of clues are strikingly diverse. Art historians and connoisseurs assign authorship, not by the overall look of a work of art, too easily faked, but by common small details like fingers or ears, which, because they are unthinkingly produced, are fingerprints of identity. Freudian psychoanalysts divine secret and conceal things from despised or unnoticed features, from the rubbish heap, as it were, of our observation. Medical diagnosticians observe the unobservable, diseases, from signs that to the inexperienced eye, ear, nose, or hand are meaningless. The origins of the method of clues, Ginzburg notes, lie deep in human history, in practices of divination and astrology, which read the unobservable minds of gods from arcane details of entrails, thrown sticks, or planetary alignments. And deeper still, one glimpses something as old as the human race, the hunter crouched in the mud, examining a quarry's tracks. From the slightest physical signs, paw prints or trails, snapped twigs, faint smells, scat bits of fur or feather, hunters read the presence of unseen prey or predators and the causes of unseen acts. In modern science, we see the method of clues in Georges Cuvier's famous trick of conjuring up extinct animals from the morphology of a single bone, and in the method by which Charles Darwin, with no hope of finding smoking gun evidence of speciation by natural selection, argued the case from innumerable small details of natural history. The method of Zadig, Thomas Henry Huxley called it, referring to Voltaire's version of the medieval Persian story of three men who correctly described a lost camel from visible traces, though they had never seen the animal itself. The method of clues is also the mainstay of historians, who must reconstruct past actions and events from fragmentary empirical records, as well as of historical sciences like archaeology, geology, and paleontology, and of the human and social sciences, which seek the origins of customs and institutions in myths and memories. To Ginsberg's list I would add ecology and systematics, which likewise look to small details to distinguish between different species and kinds of ecosystems, mythology and wildlife science, which read meanings from small clues of context and behavior, and perhaps resident science generally. Ginsberg's method of empirical clues is also a method of interpretive conjecture. In its modern usage, conjecture has connotations of careless or ill-founded reasoning, like surmise or even guess. The implied contrast is with the abstract reasoning of mathematics, idealized models, and experiment, what Ginsberg calls, with no disrespect to the historical man, the method of Galileo. That was not the original meaning of the word, however. In its pre-modern usage, the implied contrast of conjecture was not with a superior human way of knowing but with the perfect and unattainable knowledge of divinity. The word derives from the common practice in divination of throwing together. Conjecture was the best that mortal man could ever do. Ginsberg in effect revives that older meaning as a sound and serviceable way of understanding a world in which certainty is seldom, if ever, to be had by any means. It was only the powerful and terrible tool of abstraction, he writes, that in modernity made conjecture seem an imperfect second best. Conjecture, as John Gehring writes, is quickly dismissed as a matter of guesswork, inspiration or luck, a leap of faith in any case, and hence a poor subject for methodological reflection. Ginsberg mounts a vigorous defense of conjecture in science. The essential qualities of actions and phenomena lie in their particularity and the contingencies of context, so that applying the abstracting method of Galileo removes from them precisely what might make their causes and courses understandable. If clues and conjecture lack the perfect, but artificial rigor of theoretical deduction, they have an elastic rigor, a usefully paradoxical phrase, that is better suited to understanding the actual mixed-up world, because it is a rigor of direct experience of particular phenomena in context. A science of particulars. Resident science is science of particulars, though such a thing is commonly thought to be a logical impossibility. Knowledge of particulars is a practical necessity in worldly activities, but the honorific science is reserved for universals. Knowledge of particulars is know-how. This epistemic bias has deep roots. As the philosophers Samuel Gorovitz and Alistair MacIntyre have argued, it was a principle of Aristotelian philosophy that was quietly retained in the transition from medieval natural philosophy to modern science. And it persists to this day in the familiar dichotomies of pure and applied science, experiment and description, and science and common sense, as well as in a status hierarchy of sciences that elevates what is abstract and universal and demotes what is situated and particular, and blinds us to the existence of particulars as proper objects of knowledge. These habits of thought persist despite the obvious fact that the world consists of nothing else but complex particulars, which have histories and contexts too complex and contingent to be understood in terms of universal laws. Gorovitz and MacIntyre take hurricanes and salt marshes as paradigmatic subjects of a science of particulars, but just about anything that has life and agency, or that depends on the contingencies of context would also serve, that is, just about everything that is and happens in the world. Gorovitz and MacIntyre sketch out some of the basic principles of a science of particulars. One is that all things and phenomena are proper subjects of science, messy cases cannot be ruled out as not science just to save the appearance of universality. A second is that scientific laws need not be rigidly law-like, but may accommodate exceptions and counterexamples. Vaccination, for example, does reliably confer immunity, notwithstanding occasional idiopathic failures. A third principle is that history is always a necessary consideration. Omitting it in order to streamline cause and effect proofs is unscientific. Likewise with natural or biosocial contexts, these are not noise but signal, and omitting them achieves a rigor that may be illusory. A related point is that a science of particulars is a science of cases, as in common law or clinical medicine. Knowledge of all aspects of a single case may be more revealing than knowledge of a few selected variables in many cases. Gorovitz and McIntyre suggest further that in a science of particulars, deep experience of actual objects or actions will often be more fruitful than virtuoso skill in formal procedures and methodologies. What is important to the theoretical or experimental scientist is experience in research, not experience of the distinctive features of the particular crystals or molecules or other entities which provide a subject matter for the research. W. Hert is important to the meteorologist, navigator, or veterinary surgeon is an understanding of particular, individual hurricanes, cloud formations, or cows, and thus what is distinctive about them as particulars is what is crucially important. It follows that purity of formal procedure should count for less in judging the credibility of scientific products than produces knowledge of the particulars of their subjects. Bogorovitz and McIntyre's Manifesto for a Science of Particulars comes in a weak and a strong version. The weak version is a call for methodological pluralism and tolerance. The dominant interpretation of natural science, they write, must be revised so as to allow a place for our knowledge of particulars alongside our knowledge of generalizations. Live and let live, both are good in their proper places. No arguing with that. The universalizing methods of Galileo are a problem only when they become hegemonic, the one best way. The strong version of the case for a science of particulars is more contentious and interesting because it turns the conventional modern order of standing of the sciences radically upside down. In this stronger version, the thesis would insist that nature consists of nothing but more or less complex particulars, that theoretical physics is the most abstract kind of knowledge, and that it therefore always has to be based on our knowledge of particulars gained by means of sciences of the concrete. The most fundamental sciences on this view would be the disciplines concerned with our practical transactions with particulars: medicine, veterinary medicine, engineering, military and political sciences, and so on. The most abstract sciences are, in other words, not foundational to sciences of the concrete but parasitic on them. And I would include in Gorovitz and McIntyre's category of concrete science, along with applied and practical disciplines, much of human and social science, the historical sciences, ecology and environmental sciences, and potentially, any science that is pursued intensively from the inside. Themes. Of the many intriguing features of resident science, a few seem to me of particular interest. One theme that has grown on me in the drafting and redrafting of this book is how scientists' life experiences materially shape not just their choice of subjects and modes of practice, but also those practices themselves, as everyday activities and occupations become the means to scientific ends. The two essential practices of resident observing, residing and observing, are amplified forms of common activities, and my second and third themes are how they also operate as scientific practices. But finally, there is the theme of stories and storytelling. A striking feature of my cases of resident science is how practitioners use stories, of their subjects' activities and their own, not just to represent the results of their work, but also as tools of factual inquiry and reasoning. Like living, residing, and observing, storytelling is another everyday activity that becomes a practice of science. Life is science. That the common knowledge of everyday life and the expert knowledge of science are incommensurable domains has been a cardinal principle of modern science, and the logical foundation of its claim to epistemic authority. The casual activities of everyday life and the purposeful and disciplined methods of science are in this view essential in their proper spheres, yet are different modes of experience and meaning, and not to be confused or conflated. The institutions of modern science embody and sustain this view of separate worlds. Scientists almost universally enter into their vocations through the liminal institutions of formal education, where novices leave the imperfect world of common sense behind. The unreflective opinions of ordinary man is one tendentious dictionary definition of that term, and are initiated into the profession's exacting procedures and methodological dos and don'ts. The business of life is one thing, the calling of science quite another. The sociologist and philosopher Alfred Schütz has developed this idea of separate worlds into a metaphysical system in which intrusions of everyday activities into science are not just disapproved, but impossible. In everyday life, what individuals think and do is determined by personal concerns, pasts and futures, plans and projects, social interactions of friends and family, occupation and community. They're here in Schütz's terminology. When individuals enter into the social world of science, however, what they take to be important and meaningful is determined solely by the stock of accepted knowledge of their science and its communal practices. In that structure of relevances, or here, any everyday thing is irrelevant and out of place, in effect invisible to science. That being so, scientists have no way of injecting elements of everyday life into the science, except temporarily, to establish working relations with subjects as a preliminary to the science. The scientific problem, once established, determines alone the structure of relevances, Schütz writes. Though theory declares it impossible, in fact everyday occupations and activities have often been turned to scientific ends. Such cases are especially to be found in the situated, or resident sciences, where everyday material and social realities are powerfully and inescapably present in the contexts, or here, of scientific work. The illusion of separate worlds that is created in labs by material and social restrictions is harder to sustain in worldly situations. In situations of co-residence, scientific observers will be less likely to feel constrained by procedural niceties, and will be more open to making use of everyday pursuits and occupations if these seem effective means to scientific ends. Co-residence in effect reunites what philosophy and professional institutions have sundered. Schütz's metaphysics of separate worlds deliberately, and fatally, disregards the problems of the so-called sociology of knowledge. The sociology of knowledge is no longer a so-called practice, if it ever was, but one that has become foundational to contemporary views of science in the world. In light of all that we understand of the spatial and social constructedness of science, it will no longer do to assert that treatment of a scientific problem is determined solely by the problem, the stock of pertinent disciplinary knowledge, and formalities of procedure. The conventions of scientific knowing always have a degree of kinship with those of the societies in which science is carried out. The question is no longer whether everyday activities can cross over into science, but only in what contexts and how they do. In some cases, practices of resident observing have been inadvertently begun when scientists, pursuing incremental improvements in established practices, found themselves doing something new and not quite orthodox. Small steps took them across an epistemic boundary they didn't know was there. Malinowski's discovery of resident observing is a good example. In the course of a standard ethnological survey, he began to do personal interviews and observing on site, to check on informants' veracity and to give a human face to the generic data of standard questionnaires. He didn't mean to stay for long in the Trobriand Islands, but the unexpected richness of the data that came from science in residence kept him there off and on for 4 years. In the here of cohabitation, the empirical and theoretical value of participant observing became self-evident. William White came in a similar way to his sociological version of participant observing. He went to Boston's North End to carry out a standard community survey, and to gain access to the community he began to hang out with a street corner gang, of young males, only to realize halfway into his project that these groups had become subjects of a resident sociology of small groups quite different from what he had planned. Recreations of everyday life serendipitously became his science. In other cases, investigators lacking formal training in a science became resident scientists directly through their life activities, thus bypassing the rules and restrictions of a discipline. Jane Goodall's route to resident science exemplifies this pattern. She knew nothing of academic ethology when she took up residence at Gombe and began to follow and watch chimps in their forest home. She did not mean to learn or improve upon an established science, but wanted only to fulfill her youthful dream of living among wild animals in Africa. However, she was soon getting such a wealth of new and surprising information about chimp life that even doubting professional ethologists were won over. Scientists' life activities also materially shaped their field practices. Jane Goodall is again an exemplary case. Her favorite practice of habituation, openly and visibly following animals on their daily rounds and mimicking their social behaviors to get close, was one that professional ethologists generally shunned as inefficient and intrusive. Most likely it derived from Goodall's skill and experience in relating to companion species, horses, pets, and with the people in her unconventional life. Field practices of wildlife ecology likewise derived from practitioners' life experiences. Errington's fascination with the ecology of predation and his practice of reading sign came straight from his life as a commercial trapper and hunter-naturalist. And Nels Andersen's uncommon ability to get life stories from itinerant hobo workers derived from his own life as a hobo and his habit of consciously, almost sociologically, entering into each new work culture as he encountered it on his winding life's path. Unorthodox life experiences and the relaxed rules of field situations afforded varied opportunities for individuals to evade disciplinary orthodoxies and turn activities of life into science. Residing. We may not think of an activity as commonplace as residing as a scientific practice, but it can be, and not just a prologue to science, but science itself. The practices of residing are the means by which resident observers gather empirical evidence and form reasoned explanations of what they observe. Residing is relational, between observers and observed, and between both of them and their common neighbors. In the human sciences, resident observers work out a recognized identity, learn to respect local customs and participate in appropriate ways in community life, much as their subjects do in life. As the sociologist Everett Hughes put it, learning to be a field observer is like learning to live in society. I would add only that resident observing is not just like living in a society, it is living in a society. Maintaining effective relations with their subjects is how observers on the inside make residing into a scientific occupation. The role of resident observer has been usefully assimilated to the sociologist Georg Simmel's concept of the social role of stranger. Simmel's strangers are not disconnected aliens just passing through. Rather, they constitute an organic element of communities with a relation to native residents that is, paradoxically but usefully, both remote and close. Their freedom of mobility and detachment from communal commitments give strangers a unique ability to act in ways that settled members of a community cannot. Traders and moneylenders were historically the paradigmatic strangers in Simmel's sense, as were foreigners recruited to be judges or public officials because they had no local pasts and loyalties to taint their neutrality. Resident observers can likewise be trusted by residents to observe without taking sides with any local faction. Observers' dual identity as neighbors and strangers from afar also enables them to give local communities a presence and standing in the wider world. Simmel's concept reminds us that the resident observer is not an anomaly, but a scientific variant of a familiar social type, neither alien nor indigenous and both cosmopolitan and local, a bit strange perhaps, but no stranger. The ethnographer is the prototypical resident observer, the type specimen of the species, so to speak. The villagers of Omarikana assigned Malinovsky an identity and role, keeper of memories and stories, that was both familiar to them and fitting to what the ethnographer did every day, hanging out, gossiping, watching, asking questions, writing in his notebooks. Always present at dances and ceremonials, and at the unpredictable dramas of village life, he stayed largely on the sidelines and took no side. The ethnographer was part of the community, just one with an unusual identity and occupation. In a community where visitors from across the sea were routine, Trobrianders were renowned traders and blue water navigators. A resident ethnographer, though a stranger, was not all that strange. The social practices of residing thus served the investigative purposes of ethnography. Modern societies have an even greater variety of people who come and go and who in their occupations exploit the advantages of being both settled and cosmopolitan, so that resident sociologists have more varied options of the stranger's role. They can hide incognito, in some familiar local identity, or better, simply be themselves, academics working on degrees or writing books. That was how residents of Boston's North End understood and accepted William White. Being openly and only himself, a stranger but not strange without pretense, won the trust of his corner friends and subjects and made participant observing possible and fruitful. But does this relational concept of residence apply when observers' subjects are free living animals? Can observers be said to have a resident relation to creatures who normally flee at the sight of them? In some cases they can. Jane Goodall's practice of habituation was as much a relational practice of residing as anything anthropologists or sociologists did in their host communities. Physically, Goodall and her co-workers lived more or less inside the chimp's forest home and practiced the conventions of chimp social relations to get close without provoking fight or flight. The practice of habituation marked her as a resident, a stranger but no longer alarmingly strange. To her subjects, she became just another cohabiting forest animal, harmless and safely ignored. She had hoped at first for a relation of friendship, but settled for toleration. Co-residence was possible, even with creatures with whom habituation was not an option. With Bob White's, a kind of co-residence was in fact unavoidable, because the species lives by preference in areas of small farms, drawn by the abundant food and cover. Their scientific observers were co-resident in a double sense, with Bob White's, whose hidden lives they sought to reveal, and with resident farmers, on whom observers depended for access, local know-how, and support. Studdard and Errington were thus participants equally in a human and an animal ecology, and knowledge of both was vital to their science. As the English ecologist Charles Elton famously quipped, "When an ecologist says, 'There goes a badger,' he should include in his thoughts some definite idea of the animal's place in the community to which it belongs, just as if he had said, 'There goes the vicar.'" The thought extends to animal science, the point that Everett Hughes made about sociology when he wrote that learning to be a field observer was like learning to live in society. Human and animal ecologies are not worlds apart. Observing. Observing is another activity that serves both everyday life and science. Unlike residing, it has been a subject of methodological reflection by practitioners since the 17th century and recently by historians. The default view in modern science has been that observing is a necessary, but lesser preliminary, to the real science of experiment or hypothesis testing. This narrow role is the vestige of a grand and capacious domain that observers occupied in the Age of Enlightenment, an empire of observation, Lorraine Daston has called it. Observation then meant every kind of empirical work, including measurement and experiment, as well as inductive inference and hypothesis. Experiment was not yet the premier practice it would become, but simply a specialized kind of observing peculiar to a few sciences like chemistry and pneumatics. Observation was everything that natural philosophers and natural historians did, in Daston's words, a powerful, sophisticated, and deliberate empirical practice, and the essential way of reasoning in the sciences. How this empire of observation devolved is a story that remains to be told, though an outline it is clear enough. Like the modern concepts of objectivity and experiment, the narrowed concept of observation was a product of the decades in which modern science was created out of natural philosophy and natural history, in the early to mid-19th century. As experiment became a regular practice of many sciences, it came to be seen as best practice for all, leaving observation as an outmoded practice of sciences left behind by progress. We see a snapshot of this devolution in John Herschel's influential methodological treatise of 1833. Herschel still defined experiment as a kind of observation, but now a superior kind that was active and akin to the calculated probing of legal cross-examination. Plain observation was in contrast passive and akin to a rambling and often obscure story, bits of which might one day by chance prove meaningful. Experiment made progress rapid, sure, and steady. In its absence, advance was slow, uncertain, and irregular. Thus was the epistemic foundation laid for a modern empire of experiment, and observation relegated to the byways of science and the ambiguous frontiers with everyday life. In extreme cases, like neoclassical economics, observing of actual economic behavior in life would be squeezed out altogether by mechanized polling and randomized statistical analysis. Observing in situ lost its credentials as a proper tool of science. In the life sciences, butterfly collector was the stock put down for those who persisted in observing. Of course, practices of intensive and reasoning observation did survive. Observers of animal behavior in situ had never been passive watchers and recorders, one practitioner protested, but always active interpreters. In selecting what, where, and how to observe, they were as much active participators in their science as experimenters were in theirs. Observing in this older style remained a mainstay of the human and social sciences, though always in the epistemic shadow of more prestigious metric modes. That, in Carlo Ginzburg's words, became the awkward dilemma of the human sciences, and I would add, of resident sciences generally, as whole they achieve significant results from a scientifically weak position, or should they put themselves in a strong scientific position but get meager results? Ginzburg's encomium to the Sherlockian method of clues and conjectures articulates a concept of observing much like Dastan's imperial mode, with its synergy of active observing and theorizing. Resident sciences afford many instances of observing in that capacious original meaning of the term. Malinowski insisted his participant observing was a kind of empirical theorizing. Wildlife ecologists' forensic practice of reading sign was a scientific form of what hunters did in tracking prey, the ancient Fons A. Origo of Ginzburg's method of clues and conjecture. In Goodall's practice of close-in, day-in-per-day-out walking and watching, new observations deepened previous conjectures, and conjectures sharpened her eye for significant occurrences. It was the same with William White's thoughtful observing of his corner cliques. Resident observing is in general a practice of reasoning, not from abstractions but with particulars, a practice of clues and conjectures. It would not have seemed strange to citizens of that earlier and grander polity of knowledge. Stories. This book is full of stories, observer stories of their subjects' activities and their own as observers and neighbors, and of the life paths that brought observers to places of co-residence. We read Malinowski's eyewitness stories of Trobriand village life, Nels Anderson's life histories of 60 particular men who became and remained hobos, William White's stories of his activities and those of his corner boys, Jane Goodall's village tales of her chimp's distinctive personalities and lives, stories of how Herbert Stoddard's and Paul Errington's activities as hunter naturalists became their ecological science. Stories are not just a way of presenting known facts and concepts, they are also the means by which facts and concepts are produced. Observers explore and explain history and science by telling stories. A premise of these case studies.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.